In a previous video, we discussed the length of time needed for pilots to transition from narrow-body to wide-body aircraft. Today's video will continue to discuss this topic, but look at the differences in flying each type of aircraft from a pilot's perspective. Many airline pilots get the opportunity to fly both narrow-body and wide-body airliners throughout a long career. Many differences between big and small airliners have to do with the flying the planes perform. Namely, wide-bodies often fly international operations with augmented crews. Additionally, plenty of handling differences exist, particularly during taxiing and landing. So, let's go into further detail about all of these differences. First, it's important to know that it's a subjective topic. Regardless of an aircraft's size or weight, a plane is still a plane. This is to say that the aerodynamic principles of flight remain largely unchanged between a Cessna and an A380. Lift, drag, thrust, and weight are the four forces influencing flight. Larger planes just have larger numeric factors and a myriad of more advanced aerodynamic properties, of course. The gap between narrow bodies and wide bodies is even narrower than the bridge from general aviation planes to airliners, though. Every plane handles differently, and pilots notice these minor handling differences as they gain experience on a fleet, especially at lower altitudes. And so, keep in mind that describing handling characteristics is somewhat subjective. One pilot might describe a plane as nimble and responsive, while another might find the same plane stiffer. A lot of the subjectivity has to do with a pilot's flying background, no two of which are the same. A commercial airline pilot and contributor to Simple Flying, Jack Hurstam, notes that he's personally flown general aviation planes, Embraers, and Boeing 757/767s. Jack notes that the lack of any military flying in his background might predispose him to feel that a particular plane has a loose control wheel. A former military pilot might find the same plane rather stiff and lumbering. But moving on, one of the more noticeable points of difference between wide-body and narrow-body airliners is their inertia on the ground while taxiing. The 757/767 fleet makes this difference rather obvious.
A 757 with only one engine running will often be able to break away from a standstill with 50 to 70% of available thrust.
By comparison, a heavily loaded 767 practically needs both engines running to be able to taxi, especially without blowing away anything behind the engines. Taxiing wide bodies generally present more of a threat than smaller planes because of the increased jet blast and their larger wingspans. Pilots must maintain vigilance by checking NOTAMs, or Notice to Air Missions, and published charts to ensure the taxiways that they're cleared onto don't have wingspan restrictions for their planes. Ultimately, preventing ground collisions after pushback is the pilot's responsibility. And then, another major difference between narrow-body flying and wide-body flying is the presence of augmented crews, generally speaking. Flying wide-bodies means pilots work in augmented crews with three or more colleagues. This makes the job easier from an administrative standpoint, especially when getting the plane ready for departure. Generally speaking, the relief FO, or first officer, performs the walk-around, prepares the crew bunks, and generates the crew rest schedule. They can also help communicate with gate agents, flight attendants, company operations, and maintenance if needed. Having a third crew member allows the flying pilots to dedicate their attention to the flight management computer and other tasks on the flight deck. Having additional crew members on wide bodies is also helpful on arrival. Another set of eyes helps catch errors and identify unique aspects of airports that the pilots might not frequently go to. Some airlines allow first officers to bid for the relief-only role, which tends to be a more junior position. An FO with decent seniority in this position can hold more trips they want, getting exposure to parts of the operational network that other pilots on their fleet may only go to once every few years. International wide-body captains unfamiliar with an overseas operation love having an FO on the jump seat who's been to that airport a lot. It's a great addition to situational awareness that usually isn't available on narrow-body flying. Despite everything we just mentioned, it should be noted that the rise of long-haul narrow-body flights means that augmented crews may be found on these jets as well, and is indeed not exclusive to wide-body flying. And of course, at the same time, wide-bodies can be deployed on short domestic flights where augmented crews are not necessary. But again, generally speaking, those extra-long flights will be wide-bodies with augmented crews. Another difference is landing characteristics. Most people are curious about how landing a bigger plane compares to a smaller one. It generally seems that pilots with experience flying both wide-bodies and narrow-bodies believe that larger planes are easier to land. However, this is closely associated with personal perceptions. Wide-bodies have a minimum of 2 axles and 4 tyres on each main landing gear assembly. The main landing gear is also tilted so they don't all touch down simultaneously. This displaces the horizontal acceleration experienced when the tyres meet the runway during landing, spreading it out since the wheels meet the runway over a short time rather than at once. Generally, pilots will agree that it's easier to land an A330 or Boeing 767 than a Boeing 737, for example. Landing a heavier plane, like any other plane for that matter, requires pilots to be aware of the aircraft's energy state as they initiate the flare.
In general, you can get away with taking most of the power out at around 30 feet radio altitude on smaller planes.
Doing this on larger planes, depending on the engines and their response times to throttle inputs, could lead to an energy loss which makes a smooth landing impossible. You can get away with bringing the throttles to idle at 30 feet on a Pratt & Whitney equipped 757, but doing the same on a GE-equipped 767 will lead to a significantly poorer landing. This is just one example of handling differences between planes. As such, pilots fine-tune their skills as they gain experience. So, what's better, flying narrow-bodies or wide-bodies? A glance at a major airline seniority list will show that many of the pilots at the top choose to fly wide-bodies. But this might not be about the aircraft types they're flying. After all, a driving factor in this decision for wide bodies is overall compensation, generally highest for wide-body captains. There are also plenty of very senior pilots who could fly wide bodies, but choose to fly narrow bodies. Some pilots enjoy keeping a mellow body clock regimen, while others enjoy flying a plane they've known for years. And so, at the end of the day, the answer to the question of which is better is subjective, kind of like the topic of this video. And so, what do you think of the differences between piloting narrow-body aircraft versus wide-body aircraft? Are there fewer differences than you would expect? Share your thoughts by leaving a comment down below.
Simple Flying publishes over 150 articles every week. If you're looking for the latest aviation news and insights, visit simpleflying.com.